Welcome, Adam Burakowski.
Thank you.
You've recently taken over as ambassador of Poland to India, and that's at a time when we're just out of Brexit, and Poland is now looking at some changes in its dealings with the world. How do you see the situation with India, and where is the focus likely to be?
Thank you for the invitation, and thank you, the Amity University, for having me here. I'm here for 8 months as an ambassador, but before that I was coming to India many times, and I spent my 20 years of my life studying India. First time I was here in 1997, and Noida was at that time not so developed as it is right now, so I'm very happy to be here in the Amity University and to see how India is progressing. And I really feel it every day that this big progress of India, which is a very big opportunity for my country, Poland, which is also progressing. And I think that we are in a very good moment of mutual relations. We can develop it one step further. Because our trade volume just passed the $3 billion yearly, we have bigger and bigger mutual investment, both Indian in Poland and the Polish in India. And we have a growing number of Poles in India and Indians in Poland.
When you say growing number, what are the numbers now?
In the Poles in India are like 100 in Delhi and area. I also know some Polish people who live in Noida. And in total India is like 300 people. But the number of Indians in Poland is not growing, it's booming. For the last 20-25 years, the number of Indians in Poland was stable at the level of around 1,000. I know many of them. They are very, very friendly people, very well integrated into our society, and they speak Polish. They are rather well off.
But if you look at the size of Poland,
yeah,
it's a large country, yeah, in Central Europe. And then you look at India and you look at our population, those numbers are very, very small.
Yeah, but
so you really have very little interaction. Is that something that you're trying to increase and enhance?
I just said that for the last 20-25 years it was like the 1,000. Now we have 4,000 permanent and another 4,000 some seasonal people from India staying in Poland. Many of them are students. The other 4,000 are mainly students.
And also certain people who are now working in the IT sector.
Yes.
On some companies that have set up shop there.
Not only IT, because very recently, I mean, it is the case of last half a year even. Now you can see Indians everywhere in Warsaw and in other major Polish cities, because they also work for some food delivery companies. So and they play cricket, which is new to Polish society, and they are being observed very openly by the society in Poland. And this is a platform for a good interaction. I mean, the numbers are maybe not extremely big, but if you take you know, the size of our country, not your country, but our country, it is a visible development, really.
Are you looking to encourage perhaps more Indians to study in Poland or to work in Poland?
We organize some educational missions to India. Polish universities are very interested in having Indian students, because students from India are being they have an opinion of hardworking, well educated, and very success oriented. And Polish universities, they look for such students. Recently, there are more and more English language courses at the Polish universities. So The opportunities are very, very high. And I'm speaking of all kinds of universities. And this even postgraduate studies. Starting from our two best universities, which is University of Warsaw and Jagiellonia University of Krakow. Also the other universities of Wrocław, Poznań, and Gdańsk, they are looking for students, but also some smaller academic institutions are also looking for students from India. I participated myself in one of such a mission, Ahmedabad in Gujarat, like 2 months ago. And we had the representatives of 15 Polish leading universities. Warsaw University of Technology, it was there. And also some similar schools from other cities.
So what are you looking at in terms of numbers in the next year? What sort of increase in the number of student visas that you would like to see?
You know, it depends on the demand from our universities, which is very, very high, very high. I see next thousands of Indian students coming to Poland, being educated in Poland, being integrated in our society, and then if they return to India, they could be good ambassadors of Poland to India. If they stay in our country, we are also will be very happy because we are really growing very fast in economy. I mean, the GDP growth is around 4.2 last year, which creates a very big demand for high skilled personnel for Polish companies. And we look at India also in this context. But of course, the best would be the students who graduate from Polish universities.
But you're not offering any automatic work permit for a limited period after the student finishes his education. Is that something you're likely to do in the future?
This is the thing that the Polish government is now really thinking over, the new strategy of immigration. But you know, this is not the only business that we have with India. We have Polish companies investing in India. We have Indian companies investing in Poland. And just after this,
yes, of course. I was just trying to get a sense of what is likely to happen on the education front, mm-hmm. because as you rightly said, if you have a student in your country, mm-hmm. well, you have a friend for life. And Indian students are looking at opportunities globally. One of the reasons why perhaps they look at a country is because they would like to have some work experience mm-hmm. after the education.
Yes, it is possible.
So,
it is possible.
So that's a possibility.
Definitely, this is a possibility. And as I said, Polish work market needs the people, especially those better skilled, to work for the Polish companies in Poland and also abroad, because many Polish companies are present not only in Poland but also in the whole European Union market.
Coming to your area of thrust, and that's business, you want to try and now build the relationship mm-hmm. And take it to a new level. What are the areas that you want to build the business relationship in? I believe you're looking at coal and defense and areas and like that. But what are the specific areas that you have identified, and where do you see the opportunities?
Our biggest business with India is coal, and has been for decades. This is from the whole sum of more than $3 billion USD. Our export of coal to India is the biggest number. And we are trying to expand this, and especially when we speak with the government of West Bengal, because the coal of India is situated in Kolkata, and also for many other reasons. About they have a very good mining sector in Raniganj area, for example. Our companies are very interested in cooperate with Indian companies, not only by selling the coal, but also to share some technologies for more environmental friendly coal mining.
You're also looking at the defense sector, I believe, now.
No, our defense cooperation is still at not so big, not so high level, but we are trying to make it more more visible and more substantial in terms of numbers.
What about the IT sector?
The IT sector, you know, the Infosys, for example, this Indian company, their biggest European hub is in Poland, in Łódź. And I already visited their headquarters in Bengaluru, and I spoke with the their board of directors, and they are really eyeing at some new possibilities in Central Eastern Europe, and especially in Poland. And also other IT companies are interested in expanding into Poland, but also Polish companies, IT companies are present here. Mm-hmm. We are also exploring some sectors that were not so popular in our mutual exchange before, like gaming sector, I mean the computer games. There are a few companies that are trying to be present here with their products.
In the small and medium enterprises sector, what would be your thrust area?
In the small and medium. You know, the mutual exchange is generated mainly by these. As I said, that we sell coal to India is our biggest in number, but all these small and medium combined, they are bigger than the coal business. And this is textile or some parts of machinery and also chemicals. They go both ways.
With Brexit, companies from Poland have been, in fact, I believe, trying to make links with India. Why do you feel that Brexit has created opportunities for Polish companies?
Brexit is a very complex issue for Poland. I mean, being a member of the European Union, of course, we regret that one of the biggest European countries is leaving us. But this is their own decision. And if they made this decision, we want to have the best possible relationship with the UK. And the Polish-British relationship has always been very friendly. Polish pilots contributed to the Battle of Britain.
In the Second World War.
In the Second World War. Yes. Although before that, Britain gave guarantees for Poland when if Germany attacks, but they never realized. But anyway, Poland contributed to their victory, and this built some tradition. There is also a big number of Polish immigrants in the UK, and it is very, very visible, this population. Like 2 weeks ago, I received from a friend of mine some photos from Manchester that you can buy, for example, tickets to bus in a machine in Polish language in Manchester. And the Polish products in supermarkets are very visible, and this says Polish products. So. Polish population in UK is visible, very active, and the government of Poland is trying to attract them back to Poland. This one scenario, and second is to give to arrange the best possible conditions for their stay in the UK. So. Because, as I said, the Polish market demands more and more people to work in, and Polish people who had some UK experience are very, very precious for the market. That's why I want to attract them. But if they want to stay, it is the job of Polish government to secure for them the best possible conditions. And discussions about this with the government of the United Kingdom is going on. And for us, I don't think that Brexit is a problem in bilateral relations. In contrary, it could even strengthen more these bilateral relations.
How?
Because we understand that after leaving the EU, Britain would be more focused on bilateral relations and not the multilateral, because they just are leaving the biggest multilateral organization in Europe. And as I said, we had very good tradition of Polish-British friendship. And I hope that our British counterparts would also like to go in this direction. But what is opportunity for Poland in the Brexit context for Polish-Indian relation? It is the thing that Poland is the biggest country of Central Eastern Europe and could be a hub for Indian interests for this part of Europe. And we are open to be your strategic partner in this area.
But Poland itself is now having a difficult time with the European Union. The European Commission has made certain observations that Poland needs to come in line with EU systems, and there has been some strain there. How do you see that play out? Because that does affect even Indian investors into Poland.
I don't think it affects any Indian investment into Poland, really.
Your relationship with the EU?
With the European Commission? No, because this is a kind of the dialogue between a member state and the central bureaucracy. So it doesn't affect the third parties, as in India in this context.
It doesn't affect India, but the Indian investor who's investing in Poland would like to look at the total scenario and understand what exactly is likely to happen in the future.
I'm sure that there will be some positive scenario, because this is a dialogue between two partners, and at some moment in time I think we could reach a good solution, acceptable for both sides. And this is the basis of democracy and the basis on the ground on which the European Union has been built, that the voice of a member state is really listened to by the European bureaucracy. And but the European Union itself, it's the bureaucracy does not stand for all the countries. This is a place where all the countries send their representatives, but some countries are even more critical.
So what is the problem in your view? The strain, of course, seems to be that the European Union says that Poland is not following the EU principles. Is that how you see it?
This is a mutual dialogue, and this is highly mediatized. So one, I think, should listen to what is really happening and not to media reports about it. Because
so in your view, what is really happening?
I think there is some misunderstanding.
On what counts?
On the ground that the European bureaucracy does not fully understand the situation in Poland and what the government is really doing.
So could you be more specific? Exactly where is the misunderstanding?
Because the Western countries and the majority of the European bureaucracy comes from the Western countries, they still have some little misunderstandings about what is the current situation in the Central Eastern Europe, including Poland, but not only Poland, also other countries. And that we still need to reform our country and on democratic principles. So They claim that there is a threat for the rule of law in Poland, and we are trying to convince them that, that there is no threat.
The rule of law, as in the independence of the judiciary, is that?
Yes,
is that,
yes, yes. Yeah. They claim that it is like
that
this.
The judiciary should be independent and not report to political setup.
Yeah, but we are trying to show them that the reform is using some mechanism already existing in other countries from Western Europe.
So there is a similar setup in other European countries?
I mean, some parts of this setup is similar to what is happening, I mean, what is the structure of other European countries.
Could you give us some examples?
Yeah, that for example, the members of the Supreme Court are elected by politicians. You know, this happens also in other countries. So, but maybe this really mutual dialogue could lead to some compromise, in a sense that it will be maybe not the best solution, but acceptable for both sides. And since this is already going for 3 years, nothing really crucial happened yet, I think we might find a good solutions, and I don't see any threat for Indian investors in Poland about this. This is some internal EU issue between the central Brussels bureaucracy and Poland. But if you see for other countries also criticize the Brussels bureaucracy. And if we spoke about Brexit, I think one of the reasons of Brexit was the really high critics on the EU bureaucracy.
Do you think that needs to be streamlined as well, the bureaucracy?
I mean, it should more reflect the national interests of member states.
That's been a debate that's been on for a while now.
Yeah.
But do you think this debate is likely to weaken the European Union as such?
I think if we reached a good solution, as I said, acceptable for both sides, it could be a good model for the next development of the European Union. This is because in my opinion, the European Union should be more focused on the national interests of member states and not on the interests of the Brussels bureaucracy.
Are you likely to find a solution in the next year, because you are coming up for a general election next year?
It might be possible. Yes, I think so. We see after 1 year what happened, but maybe. I'm not excluding any. This dialogue is going on for 3 years already. So I think that after these 3 years, both sides understand their partners better.
I want to take you back to the Second World War. Mm-hmm. That's a time when Polish children came to India. And as you know, the story has been quoted many times over in Poland and India. As to how they got refuge here and lived here and then went back. And that is a very old and strong link between the two countries. You yourself are now planning to take this issue and bring it to the forefront and build on it. What exactly have you got planned?
We plan a big event in Jamnagar, and more precise, in Balachari. Balachari is a small village near Jamnagar. This is the place where during the Second World War around 1,000 Polish orphans, Polish children, were kept in a refugee camp by the Maharaja of Navanagar. Now it's the name of this place, of the city, Jamnagar. The name of Maharaja was Jam Saheb Digvijay Singh Ji. And he really helped these Polish children, and he wanted just one thing for this, that one school in Warsaw should be named after him. And I am the graduate of this school named after him, which I'm very proud of. So on 30th of September, we are bringing the people who were children at that time, and now they are elder people. We are bringing them back to Balachari, and we want to celebrate this this very moment of Indian-Polish common history, the moment where India showed the hospitality during the very severe moments of Second World War.
And you plan to do this towards the end of the year, this year?
This September, I mean 30th of September.
30, okay.
Yes, in Balachari near Jamnagar. A big event with the presence of Chief Minister of Gujarat, Sri Vijay Rupani.
If it's okay with you now, we'll take a few questions from the audience. We have a number of people here who would like to ask you something about Poland and India, I guess. Yes, please.
I'm Chaitanya Srivastav, first year Bachelor of Arts in Journalism and Mass Communication. My question to you is that, sir, this year Poland came back after 20 years to the non-permanent house of the Security Council. And it was about, the speech was about strengthening the international laws that are present. So, sir, what are the international laws in response to the development of the developing nations like India that Poland is taking under?
So, this really was a big achievement to be in the Security Council. And I can tell you that Poland and India are based on similar principles. This is peace and democracy. And by strengthening the international laws, we mean that we totally agree with the whole idea of international laws, and we would like to them to be implemented in every corner of the world, and Poland is really, really committed to this issue.
Yes, please.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Yash Raj from Bachelor's in Journalism and Mass Communication. So I just wanted to ask you, like you being a diplomat, what do you think the impact of diplomacy in terms of media?
So that's an interesting question.
Yes.
Diplomacy and media.
I can tell you that if your name is Yash Raj, you have a very good name for media. And the Yash Raj company also cooperated with some Polish people. So I think media are very important in nowadays world. And being a diplomat, I'm trying to be present in media as much as I can, and to present the opportunities of business with Poland for Indians, and also to present some things that are interesting in Poland. As I said, I'm coming to India frequently for the last 20 years, and I know that Poland is not a very well-known country in India, but there is only one thing that everybody knows about Poland, that Poland is a cold country. But to this I always say that Poland is a cool country, because we are very cool, we are really an interesting country, full of opportunities, and Polish people are very friendly.
And I also have another question. How much international student can expect being like in your country? How much exposure we can get in terms of media?
So what he's trying to say is that if he chooses to study in Poland, as opposed to one of the other countries in the world where he has an opportunity to go, how would it position him in terms of exposure to the world?
Yeah, so as I said, we still don't have too many media in Poland with English version. If you knew Polish language and you have, you are from India and you have a good background, you become a media star very soon. I know one of my friend, Kartiki Johri. He is honorary consul of India in Wrocław, and he knows Polish very well. And he is really a media man, and he's very popular in Polish television. And I can tell you also that there is a Polish singer, Michał Rudaś, who is now taking part in the talent contest in Star Plus television in India, in Mumbai. And the name of the show is Dil Hai Hindustani. Yes, and he is being I hope he will qualify to the final, which is coming the end of September.
How difficult is it, in your view, for a person who speaks Hindi to learn Polish? You know both languages. Mm-hmm. You studied Hindi as well.
Yes.
So
yes.
How do you see it?
Polish is one of the most difficult languages in the world.
So you have to be very committed, yes.
Yes, you have to be very committed because of the grammar and especially the pronunciation. This is very difficult. I think Hindi is much more simple, is simpler. For me, the most difficult part of Hindi is that you have many words for one thing. The biggest problem that I face with your language.
Hello, sir. My name is Loni. I'm from Kolkata, and you mentioned the place in regard to the green coal mining activities. So how do you plan to start there? I'm really curious about that.
Thank you for this question. I'm going to Kolkata next week. We have very good relations, especially with Minister Amit Mitra, who is responsible for energy. And I'm meeting him next week. We created in Poland the so-called West Bengal project. There are three ministries involved. This is Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Ministry of Entrepreneurship and Technology, and Ministry of Energy. And also some Polish coal mining enterprises. And now, as I know, the West Bengal government is creating something similar on their side. And the issue is to increase what is already happening. As I said, this is our biggest business, to sell the coal to India, but also we would like to sell the technologies for more environmental friendly coal mining. And our companies are in contact with your companies, and they are trying to find the good solutions for this. And as I said, Kolkata is one of the places that I am frequently going. And about Kolkata, I can tell you that I was there in Kolkata in September 1997 when Mother Teresa died. I've been that day in Kolkata. I attended her funeral. So for me, this is really a very important place. And I like the poetry of Rabindranath Tagore, and also the music based on his poetry, especially the singer Debendra Biswas.
And we'll take a last question. Yes, please.
Good evening, sir. Myself is Shakha, and I'm a student of Bachelor's in Journalism and Mass Communication. Sir, being an Indian, being the youth of India, I have actually been experiencing the media convergence, a global media convergence in our country. So, sir, as you have been to India before also, what do you think that how far we have been succeeding in reaching the horizons of maintaining international relationships in the terms of media industry?
I think that the Indian media, I like Indian media. This is my, I really like Indian media, and I'm following Indian media for all these 20 years. I really appreciate the freedom of speech which is in India. This is one of my strongest beliefs, that freedom of speech is something very, very precious, very, very precious. And I see the changing face of Indian media. I remember the times where there was basically only state-owned TV, and now there is plenty of them. But I especially like the Indian social media. They're really interesting, and how the news is spreading through the social media is fascinating for me. Fascinating. And I'm trying to follow the social media and the languages that I know. Unfortunately, Bengali is not one of them, but I'll try to be better.
Well, we wish you luck.
Thank you.
And thank you for sharing views with us.
Thank you.